Welcome to the fourth and final webinar in the Moving Forward, Redefining the American Textile Conversation series. This week, I'll be meeting with Precious Lavelle, and our topic is The Ancestors' Call. The way the format for the webinar is that I'll be talking to you for a couple minutes, and then Precious will speak and will share her images, and then we will, and then the two of us will be together in conversation, and we'll finish it up with questions from the audience. Let me give you a little information about Precious. Precious Lavelle received her BFA from Virginia Commonwealth University and her MFA from North Carolina State University. She's a faculty member of Moore College of Art and Design in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Precious explores the narrative potential of cloth and clothing. She refers to herself as a stitching griot who sees cloth and clothing as a visual language. As she explores this language, she tries to discover a vocabulary that speaks to the extraordinary in the ordinary materials and objects, uncovering new stories that uplift people of African descent, in particular women who've often been forgotten. In one of our discussions preparing for this conversation, Precious expressed to me how important it was for her art practice to stitch, and that she likes, you know, that she thinks about stitching every day. And the reason for this is because it gives her a direct link to her ancestors. With that, I'm going to turn it over to Precious to share her images. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. First, I would like to thank Karen for this invitation to talk about my work. I am Precious, daughter of Rachel, daughter of Lena, daughter of Rachel, and daughter of those who came before, whose names I do not know, but who I am certain know my name and are with me always. These women are the shoulders on which I stand. Sawubona is a Zulu greeting that means we see you, we acknowledge you. Rosh Mamabolo explained the greeting this way. The eye is a connection to an ancient lineage of family and artistry. It means that my lineage, my family, my ancestry is always with me. I am never alone. Personally, I need my ancestral angels now more than ever. Mamabolo says, until we see someone, we cannot respect them. I make my work as a response to the myths that have brought us to this moment in American and world history. I endeavor to counter and dispel the false and fabricated histories assigned to people of African descent by dominant culture, so that when we are seen for who we truly are, I'll give you an overview of some of my work now, and I can address specifics during Q&A, or you can check out my work on my website. This slide is The Ties That Bind, a collection of 15 aprons that represent my female ancestors and support system. Dr. Lonnie G. Bunch III, founding director of the National Museum of African American Culture, said that we as African Americans should honor all of our ancestors by remembering the well-known, but also by remembering those famous only to their families, whose lives in quiet ways shaped this nation. These aprons were based on African modesty aprons to dispel the notion that African descended women were sexual beasts justifying the rape of them by slaveholders. I'll share a few of my aprons now. And on the waistband of each apron is a code to my relationship to that ancestor. The first apron is Perlina Arnold. She represents my mother's paternal grandmother. She died at 17 years of age, shortly before her only child, my grandfather, was a year old. Childbirth was all I ever heard about her, that was associated with her. She died from complications of giving birth to my maternal grandfather. Grandpa Arnold was the indisputable patriarch of our family and lived to be 101 years old. His father was the son-in-law of the slaveholder who owned Perlina. The middle apron is Mary Elizabeth Johnson Tatum. It represents my mother's aunt, and she raised my mother. My great aunt Lizzie lived with us. She was a domestic worker for two white families in the town where I lived. I remember her getting dressed in the morning and tying on a starched white apron before she went to work. This patched and blood-stained apron represents the blood, sweat, and tears of the lives of many African-American women working in service. The third apron represents my father's paternal grandmother, America Martin Lavelle, known to me as Granny Mag. We were very close, and I used to sit on her floor and work the pedal of her machine when she sewed. I remember a crazy quilt pillow that she made that we had at home. It had a black background, and I always referred to it as my pillow. She lived next door to us, and I went to her house every day after school. My Uncle Jim, my father's brother, was the griot or historian of our family. During a conversation, he asked me if I knew Granny Mag's real name. I said no. And then he told me that it was America. This apron represents my unknown African-American female ancestors. They are reflected in the diamond shapes as symbols for the cycle of life, birth, death, and rebirth. The middle passage ripped lives apart and turned them inside out. Over time, African Americans have continued to reorder their lives and put them back together. Sorry, I am completely out of order here. Okay, this slide is I will talk about Warrior Women of the African Diaspora. The Warrior Women AD Project was born in the West African country of Ghana, where I encountered a statue of the Asante Queen Ya Asantewa, wearing a war shirt covered with amulets, traditional male apparel. This statue sparked the idea for the Warrior Women of the African Diaspora Project. I was familiar with warrior hunter shirts and their protective powers, but I had never seen or been aware that women wore them. Then I thought to myself, women of the African diaspora have fought for freedom just like men since enslavement and colonization began. So I decided to create protective cloths in the form of traditional warrior hunter shirts for a variety of warrior women of the African diaspora to honor their memories. This is the installation of the 7 original shirts. There are now 15 shirts in this series. The setting is an imaginary location in the woods. The ground is scattered with pine cones and leaves to enhance the idea of an outdoor meeting. A large cast iron pot has been turned upside down and placed in the center of the circle. During enslavement, many enslaved people believed that if an iron pot or kettle were turned upside down, it would muffle the sound of the conversation at hand and prevent the slaveholders from hearing what was being discussed. The women are gathered together in sisterhood in a sacred circle representing infinity. They have come together in camaraderie and solidarity, offering songs and prayers. Although they know such a gathering is risky, they also know that there is strength in numbers. Ya Asantewa, The inspiration for this series was an Asante queen in Ghana who fought the British when they captured King Prempeh I and then demanded the most sacred possession of the Asante kingdom, the Golden Stool. While the Asante chiefs were debating the best way to handle the abduction and cultural insult, Ya Asantewaa boldly told them that if they were afraid, she would organize the women and fight the British. She said, "Now, I have seen that some of you fear to go forward to fight for our king. If it were the brave days, chiefs would not sit down to see their king taken away without firing a shot. No white man could have dared to speak to the chief of the Asante in the way the governor spoke to you chiefs this morning. Is it true that the bravery of the Asante is no more? I cannot believe it. It cannot be. I must say this. If you, the men of the Asante, will not go forward, then we will. We, the women, will. I shall call upon my fellow women. We will fight the white men. We will fight till the last of us dies in the battlefields. I gold leafed the shirt to represent Asante gold. I used brass safety pins to embellish the shirt and enhance the concept of dripping in gold. I laser cut Adinkra symbols, which are according to my friend Saki Mafundikwe in his book, African Alphabets, The Story of Writing in Africa. They are from the Akan people of Ghana and Cote d'Ivoire. They originated over 400 years ago and they represent proverbs, historical events, attitudes, as well as objects, animals, and plants. The symbols I used are as follows. The symbol that looks like an X is a symbol of independence, freedom, and emancipation. The one that looks sort of like a bunny is a symbol of bravery and valor. The four hearts, symbol of God's presence and protection. The Orthodox cross, a symbol of strength, bravery, and power. And the heart-shaped symbol, Sankofa, is a symbol of importance of learning from the past in order to move forward. Nanny of the Maroons was born of the Akan ethnic group like Ya Asantewaa in what is present day Ghana. She was brought to Jamaica as an enslaved African. She escaped into the mountains and with her brothers and others fought off the British from approximately 1725 to 1740. Queen Nanny, as she is also known, taught her troops the art of camouflage to make themselves invisible to the British. Once when the Maroons, a name for escaped slaves, had retreated into the hills to avoid the British and were in danger of starvation, Queen Nanny planted pumpkin seeds that she found in her pocket. The pumpkins grew miraculously and the Maroons were fed, and this attributed to the belief that she was an Obe or magic woman. Nanny of the Maroons is a national hero in Jamaica and her image appears on their $500 bill. Her exact date and place of death are unknown, although many say she died in 1755. This string shirt allows the viewer to see through the shirt, reflecting Queen Nanny's invisibility. Gold pumpkin seeds are in the invisible breast, and I gold leaf them again as a reference to Asante gold. And they were put in her breast, representing the fact that she fed her starving troops. There are 83 bells that represent the total 83 years that the Maroons were able to fight off the British. And the bells are along the hem. I also think the bells might've been something Queen Nanny would have used to lure the British into striking distance while remaining invisible to them under the cover of camouflage. Harriet Tubman was an enslaved African in the United States. She is best known for her role as a conductor on the Underground Railroad, for which she has been credited with leading 300 enslaved people to freedom. For these efforts, she was known as Moses. She also earned the name General Tubman when in 1863, she organized and led 150 Black troops under the command of Colonel Montgomery in a Civil War rebellion along the Combahee River in South Carolina, helping to free 700 enslaved people. The shirt I made for Harriet Tubman combines both of her roles as Moses leading her people to freedom and as General Tubman leading troops in the Union Army. The cloth is made with Osnaburg, sometimes referred to as Negro cloth. It was one of the rough fabrics supplied to enslaved Africans once a year by their owners for clothing. On the shirt, it is covered with 300 hand-dyed, handmade dolls representing the 300 slaves she led safely to freedom, and they are now protecting her. And there is a close-up there on the right of the dolls, a male and female. There are epaulets on her shoulder, four stars representing the rank of general, which was established in 1866. Although she led troops 3 years earlier, I decided Miss Tubman deserved proper recognition. Cowrie shells, I use them to embellish the epaulets, and they are symbols of prestige and femininity. And they also join the dolls along the side of the shirt. In 2017, I was awarded an artist fellowship at the Instituto Sacatar in Itaparica, Brazil, to expand my Warrior Women of the African Diaspora series. During my 8-week residency, I created a shirt for Maria Felipa Gioleveira, a free Afro-Brazilian woman who was born into slavery on the island of Itaparica. Local legend states that in 1823, she led 40 female fishmonger colleagues and seduced the men of the Portuguese military. Once the men were naked, they were beaten with the indigenous plant Consenso, which immobilized them. This allowed the women to burn 42 Portuguese ships in the Bay of All Saints and prevent an attack on Salvador, the colonial capital of Brazil across the bay. Itaparica is an island in the Bay of All Saints off the coast of Salvador. Salvador, which is in the state of Bahia, is home. Bahia is home to the largest population of people of African descent outside of Africa. Over 4 million Africans were transported to Brazil and enslaved, roughly 10 times as many as were taken to America. During this colonization, several European embroidery techniques were introduced to Brazil. Over time, they were embraced and studied by Afro-Brazilian women and became integral to Afro-Brazilian culture and religion. This was the first shirt in my series to be a collaborative effort of making. I explored textile traditions associated with Afro-Brazilian women and commissioned pieces to be incorporated into the shirt, including cutwork embroidery and bobbin lace. It became a multi-generational collaborative experience. I collaborated with Iraci Alves da Silva, a cutwork artisan who was 80 years old and supposedly the last cutwork embroidery artisan on the island of Itaparica. The bobbin lace was made by women on Ilha Jamare, Daisy Souza dos Santos and Barbara Maria Souza Duarte Magalhães, both bobbin lace artisans, and Pielson Souza dos Santos, who was the bobbin lace technical designer. The shirt is adorned with a cutwork panel, bobbin lace amulets, and colorful beads representing the three female orishas, or goddesses of the Candomblé religion, who were believed to have assisted Maria Felipa Gioleveira. Iemanjá, the goddess of the sea, whose bead colors are light blue and clear. Osun, the goddess of fresh water and also a seductress. Her beads are yellow and amber. And Yanzan, a warrior goddess. Her bead colors are dark red and brown. Also included are cultural motifs, including the figa and black power fist. Cowrie shells were included because of their many associations with the African continent. I tied a fishnet body of the shirt to symbolize that even an ordinary fisherwoman has the power to do something extraordinary. The bobbin lace amulets are as follows. The lightning bolt and the sword represents Yansan. The mirror, Yemanjá, and Osun. The seashells and fish, Yemanjá, and the figa with it, the finger through the fist, is the good luck symbol in Brazil. And the fist is a black power fist. And Sankofa, which I mentioned earlier, the Adinkra symbol that emphasizes the importance of understanding and learning from the past, has become a symbol for Maria Felipa. The cutwork panel on the front of the shirt features Maria Felipa with a torch in her hand and a bunch of consenso in her left. The other details I'm happy to elaborate on later. Blood, sweat, and tears. They are a collection of three garments inspired by actual slave narratives that reflect the atrocities of African enslavement in the United States of America. The narratives are as follows. Blood. I never saw a jail for slaves, but I have seen slaves whipped. I saw Creighton Abernathy, an overseer, whip a woman in a cotton path on Doc Smith's farm a mile from our plantation. I also saw old man Crump, an owner, whip a man and some children. He waited till Sunday morning to whip his slaves. He would get ready to go to church, have his horse hitched up to the buggy, and then call his slaves out and whip them before he went to church. He generally whipped about five children every Sunday morning. This was the narrative of Elias Thomas. Sweat, this is the narrative for Sweat. The hands are required to be in the cotton field as soon as it is light in the morning. And with the exception of 10 or 15 minutes, which is given them at noon to swallow their allowance of cold bacon, they are not permitted to be one moment idle until it is too dark to see. And when the moon is full, they oftentimes work, labor till the middle of the night. No matter how fatigued and weary he may be, no matter how he longs for sleep and rest, a slave never approaches the gin house with his basket of cotton without fear. If it falls short in weight, if he has not performed the full task appointed him, he knows that he must suffer. And if he has exceeded it by 10 or 20 pounds, in all probability, his master will measure the next day's task accordingly. So whether he has too little or too much, his approach to the gin house is always with fear and trembling. Solomon Northrop, who you may remember from 12 Years a Slave. Tears. But to the slave mother, New Year's Day comes laden with peculiar sorrows. She sits on her cold cabin floor watching the children who may be torn from her the next morning. And often does she wish that she and they might die before day dawns. She may be an ignorant creature degraded by the system that has brutalized her from childhood, but she has a mother's instincts and is capable of feeling a mother's agonies. On one of these days, I saw a mother lead seven children to the auction block. She knew that some of them would be taken from her, but they took all. I met that mother in the street. Her wild, haggard face lives today in my mind. She wrung her hands in anguish and exclaimed, "Gone, all gone. Why don't God kill me?" And this was from Harriet Jacobs, a fellow North Carolinian, and from the incidents in the life of a slave girl. Legacy of the N-word. Enslaved, incarcerated, insanity, indestructible. I created this performative piece in 2017 in anticipation of 2019, the anniversary of 400 years since the first ship landed at Point Pleasant, Virginia, with African captives for the purpose of servitude. It was inspired by this quote by the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. "Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. We are caught in an inescapable network of mutuality, tied in a single garment of destiny. Whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly." It consists of a straight jacket with sleeves that morph into the shoulder strap of a cotton picking sack with the date 1619 printed on the front. Cotton bowls are scattered around the sack on the floor. It is juxtaposed with a black hoodie referencing Trayvon Martin, printed with the date 2019 on the front, and on the back, what appears to be a shooting target. There are empty bullet casings strewn on the floor around the hoodie. 1619, referencing the year the ships arrived, and prison identification numbers are on the picture on the left. In the center image, it is a Dikanga da Congo or Congo cosmogram, not a shooting target. It represents the four stations of the sun or the four stages of life: birth, life, death, and rebirth. And on the right, the 2019 hoodie, this time worn by a woman, reminding us that African-American women like Breonna Taylor and many others have been victims of state-sanctioned violence against African-Americans in addition to men. And finally, time's effing up. Jacqueline Kennedy's pink Chanel suit, pink Chanel-like suit, Monica Lewinsky's notorious blue dress, Michelle Obama's sleeveless black dress for her official White House portrait. What women have worn at pivotal moments in their lives have become tied to their identities and the stories of those defining moments. I have simulated one of the suits worn by attorney and law professor Anita Hill during the 1991 Senate Judiciary Committees for the confirmation of Clarence Thomas to the Supreme Court. During the hearings, Ms. Hill detailed instances of sexual harassment that she endured from Thomas. Yet her testimony fell on deaf ears, and the Senate Judiciary Committee confirmed Thomas's nomination. Hill's reputation, however, was maligned at every turn by Thomas supporters, and she was infamously labeled a little bit nutty and a little bit slutty by journalist David Brock. Recent events have proven that Anita Hill endured not, that what Anita Hill endured was not isolated event, but has been status quo in the political arena and beyond since time immemorial. With time's effing up, I am repositioning this fearless woman of African descent who, against all odds, did what she believed was the right thing to do. I embroidered a scarlet A for both her name and its symbolism. Although she was not on trial, it was she who was branded a wanton woman. The 14 white men who served on the Senate Judiciary Committee with Joe Biden as the chair are stitched around the hem of the jacket. Their unscrupulous questioning served to vilify her and secure Thomas a place on the Supreme Court. On the back of the jacket, I stitched a quote by Hill that seems to sum up the goal of the hearings. She said, "I became the messenger who had to be killed." On the skirt, I embroidered the names of some of the political figures, AKA skirt chasers, who have been involved in sexual scandals since the US political system began. Clarence Thomas figures prominently, and Strom Thurmond was both a member of the committee that questioned Hill and involved in a sexual scandal that revealed he had impregnated a 15-year-old African-American girl that resulted in the birth of a daughter. Referencing Hill's quote, "There is a black Victorian dress on the floor underneath the suit. It is called widow's weeds and was worn by women to mourn the deaths of their husbands. This dress has a double meaning in this work. First, it represents Hill rising out of the ashes like a phoenix from the Senate Judiciary Committee's attempt to kill her. And second, it reconfirms the death of the Victorian notion that a woman's place was in the home where she remained self-sacrificing, uneducated, and pure. Finally, I created several mourning ribbons embroidered with messages asserting that the time has come to put to death anything that threatens a woman's ability to live with dignity and without fear. Thank you."
Jane, can you put my image back on the screen?
Karen, I can see you, Karen.
Well, it's not showing up on mine, so I just don't understand. Okay, so if people can see both of us, then that's good. First off, that was incredible, Precious.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you so much. I want to just step back for a moment because I forgot to say something very important in my intro, which is that I really owe the Center of Craft for Craft everything in making this possible because of a grant from the Craft Future Fund. And I also need to thank BRM Production and Management for everything, because they have just really been incredibly supportive in making everything happen. So now let me get on to talking with you.
Okay.
I just loved it. And there, you know, and let me just fill in some stuff for the audience so that Precious and I met 2 years ago. We had never met before two years ago. And for about 20 years, our work piggybacked off of each other is the best way that I can describe it. I mean, you know, and so a lot of my questions really come from that. When did you first start working with ancestral lineage and start seeing that as your driving force? And what took you in that direction?
Well, to be perfectly honest, Karen, I haven't been at this that long. I was a fashion designer for 20 years in New York City. And so it's been about, 11 years or so since I really started with this. But, I grew up in a family that was all about family on both sides, my mother's side and my father's side. We had family reunions. We talked about, you know, our ancestors. We were made to be proud of who we were and who we came from, with all of its history, the good, the bad, the ugly, all of it. So I've always been interested in those things. But as you know, I am an avid traveler, and I've just always been interested in humanity. And in the seventh grade, I had a social studies course, and we talked about the untouchables. And my mind was blown that there were human beings that were supposedly so low you couldn't touch them. And that made me just want to see the world. But when I thought about the untouchables, there was sort of this parallel with the horrors of enslavement in the United States. And, this idea of people being so lowly that they could be treated anyway, you know, without any repercussions, you know, things like the shirt about being whipped, you know, on Sunday morning before you go to church. So ancestry has always been important to me, whether it is my direct ancestry or the broader sense of my African ancestors.
So, you know, but I still want to dig into that a little bit more.
And okay.
What made you branch from fashion?
Oh, okay. Well, that is really fashion related. I love to make. I'm a maker, avid maker. I became disheartened with the industry because it became so elitist, so, you know, narrowly focused. It became all about celebrity and all of these things that, you know, it was harming the environment, all of these many things. And so that was one of the big reasons that I really moved away from doing things as a fashion designer, but I still understood the importance of cloth and clothing for communicating things. And so that's why I continue to work with cloth and clothing. So when I went to graduate school, I studied fibers and surface design, and I realized that cloth and clothing could be used to tell stories. You know, every day we get up, we get dressed, and we present ourselves to the world, you know, through clothing. And so I knew that it was really important and it had a lot of value. And that's one of the reasons that I transitioned from being a fashion designer to being using textiles and clothing in an art form. I do think, however, that with this COVID situation and the fact that we have seen the environment repair itself and all of these amazing things happen, maybe the fashion industry has finally learned a lesson, and maybe we will become more conscious in, with clothing making, with slow fashion and all of these other movements that are happening. So I'm a little more hopeful about that than I ever was. But at this stage in my life, I'm not going back to be a designer. That's, you know, it's really focused on telling stories.
So you went, when you went to Saqqatar, you went to Saqqatar in, did you go in 17?
I went in summer of 17.
Okay, so just for the audience, I was granted the same residency in 2015. And so we have, you know, this was like one of our first things that we discovered that we had in common. And it's an 8-week residency where a group of 5 people from different countries, 5 artists from different countries, are all brought together to live in this incredible house with studios lying all over the property. And the goal for everyone is that they have a research project while they're there. And so it's so interesting to me because when I went in 2015, I was working with the lace, with another group of lace makers on the island. And was going and really, you know, really just exploring. And I was very curious because it happens to be that that Bahia, which is Black Brazil, for anyone that doesn't understand, is one of the only places in the world where brown women make lace. And so, you know, in my whole discovery, which is really following brown and black women and their crafts around the world, their textile crafts, you know, that it took us both there.
Yeah, it was, oh, I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, 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 go on.
Yeah, it was, I had been to Brazil 19 years earlier as a tourist, but had encountered some of the making at one of the markets, and I was aware of that. And the, you know, the moment that the call, I heard about Sacatar, I applied because I knew this was something that I wanted, you know, to explore further. And at the same time, I had been experiencing pain with my hands from stitching. I've been stitching since I was 6 years old. So I said, you know, let me try something collaborative. And when I got there, you know, Sacatar was the most extraordinary experience because you got to go there and do nothing but concentrate on making art. They made sure everything was taken care of, your food, washing your clothes, everything. And they had connections to the community. So when I told them what I was, you know, they met with each of us and you tell them what you're trying to work on, and immediately they went into action and hooked me up with the people that I needed. And, you know, my first, this is a great story. My first communication with Iraci, who was 80 years old, I went to her house. She was in walking distance of the Institute. And Augusto, the manager, went with me that first time to translate. And it was like, I don't know. Augusto had said a couple of sentences. I was sitting on the couch with her and I was flipping through my book. And all of a sudden, we didn't even need Augusto. We didn't speak the same language, but we spoke through making and through textiles. And she was giving me the thumbs up and putting her arms around me. And it was just, and I was like, okay, I'm good to go here. And, you know, so that was really an amazing experience. And with the women on Ilha Jumare, we worked via cell phone images. It was amazing. And then the last day they came to the Institute and delivered everything, and it was extraordinary. It was really such an amazing experience, but it, what was the best part about it was that it was a multi-generational collaboration. Daisy and the ladies on Ilha Jumare were like in their mid to late 30s. I was, you know, late 50s, and Iraci was 80. I mean, what could have been better than to span that, you know, those generations and do this project together? I think it, for it may be of all my projects, my favorite project because of that collaborative effort.
When you were there, when I was there, I went to a number of Candomblé ceremonies as well as a Baba Ogun. Did you?
I had been to Candomblé ceremonies when I was there 19 years earlier. And then we did go to one this time, which was actually, it was, I guess, this one Augusto took us to. And this, these were his group of people. So it was an amazing experience. It always is. The dancing, people were being, you know, initiated, the part that the public can see. And it was beautiful. It was beautiful. It always is. The music, the movement, the crowns, the clothing, everything. So yes.
Yeah, I came back, really, that's what inspired my work for like the next couple years.
Yes, I saw one of your pieces with the Agungun. It looks like it was from something that you saw at maybe one of the Agungun performances. And those things, you know, it's interesting
because when we think of Egungun ceremonies, we usually think of West Africa, Nigeria. But these things came with enslavement. People did not forget who they were, you know?
Well, you know what, they told us was that Itaparica Rica is the only place outside of Nigeria where it's practiced.
Yep. And it's Itaparica, the island itself is where it happens, which is really interesting. Yeah. It's not Salvador or anywhere else in Bahia, but it is Itaparica. And you know, akarajé, the food that the women make on the streets, mm-hmm. came directly from Nigeria also. So, you know, that's the beauty of Brazil, is that people held on to things like that. It, you know, there's still pano de costa, the cloth that they wrap themselves in. Again, you know, cloth of the coast. And that's the women who wear it now, the Sisters of the Boa Moche and all of those ladies, mm-hmm. they're referencing their African heritage. It's beautiful.
So I've got another question. So with your shirt for Nanny, mm-hmm. What was it that made you choose Nanny as?
Well, it's, okay. When I first saw Jacintoa Ngana, I came home, I said, okay, I want to do 7 shirts, the number of completion, you know, all of that reference. And so I started looking up women, and I started this series in 2009, and there was so little information on so many women. So the original 7 were the ones that I could find the most information on at that time. Now, Zeferina, who was from Brazil, I could only find, I think, 4 sentences about this woman in all literature, Portuguese or otherwise, you know? And so I tried to use the women that I could find the most information on. Now, what's interesting is that over 11 years, there's been so much more information that's out there about these people, but reflective of how times are changing. Right. Now we are starting to tell our own stories and not depend on the stories that have been written about us. And now there's more information coming out. So that she was just one of the original 7 and that I could find good information on that was, you know, fought against enslavement. And that's why she was chosen. I wish I had a much deeper reason, but her story was also so visual and such a powerful story, which all of them are. You know, when I talk about Zeferina, she fought with bows and arrows. So when she was captured, they cut off her arms. She was a fearless bow, you know, mm-hmm. Had fearless ability with a bow and arrow. So I was attracted to the stories.
I just love it. I really do. I love your choice of materials. I love the way that you, that really you're putting, you know, you're really going in and asking each one of the women what they should be.
Always. That I do that always. I always say, you know, I have this folder of women. And I always say, I'm waiting for you to tell me when you need to be born, mm-hmm. when you're ready to come into the world. And they always do. They always do. I don't have to force it. All of it, out of the blue, it said, okay, time for this one to come into the world. And that's pretty much how I go about doing them, is I just wait for them to tell me when, and I try to heed and listen and honor them as best I can. And I can I just ask you a question?
Yeah.
And when I see your work and I see that you use a lot of traditional African textiles, kuba cloth and woven raffia and all of these things, why do you choose those fabrics? What has inspired you to use them?
Uh-huh. So let's see, you know, I, like you, I started sewing when I was very young. Uh-huh. And so I knew fabrics very well. And when I started, you know, with weaving and really knowing yarns from around the world. And because I spun so much when I was younger, you know, in my 20s and stuff. And I really loved coarse cloth. I was always drawn to coarse cloth. So very early on, I started, when I was weaving, I was searching out coarse cloth. I mean, coarse yarns mm-hmm. to make my own coarse cloth. And, you know, but I was always subject to the market, you know, what was around. Yeah. And I would buy specialty yarns and stuff like that. And I first started working, well, I was interested in the early 90s, I became really interested in Cuba cloth. Mm-hmm. And my life kind of is one where something has to grab me, you know, to really take me there. And this was kind of what the experience that changed my life was, that I went to a conference and I listened to a leading authority on Cuba cloth, mm-hmm. you know, give this talk. And I found it so disrespectful in the way that this anthropologist gave it. So it was what years later sent me to grad school, because I was angry. Mm-hmm. And so I felt like I needed to know it. And in the early 2000s, I was working at a children's museum, and the children's museum, there used to be a gallery in San Francisco called Xanadu Gallery, and they used to have a lending library. And years went, and then they closed it, and I was long gone. But the woman that ran it contacted me, and she said, I have a number of old things that you know, that can't be used, they can't be sold or anything else. And so I was given a Cuba cloth that was really like was threadbare and stuff. And I said, well, this is just, it's raffia cloth. And I was doing a lot of other projects with raffia cloth because I could buy it, because mm-hmm. I wasn't going to make it. And I started doing this patchwork with it. And I started using different techniques with it. And so I built, and I was dyeing it, and I found out, you know, different kinds of dyes worked on it, and it really was different. And so I just kept working with it, and gradually with my other raffia pieces, I was doing a lot of, what is it? I was working with dye sublimation printing mm-hmm. and with pigment printing, and doing pigment printing on raffia, and I found these incredible results, you know. But I have to travel to really activate a lot of that mm-hmm. and so it's by, you know, I have all the skills, and then by going to these places, like in, when I was in Northern Nevada and I visited, I went to one of the largest petroglyph sites mm-hmm. and it was like, you know, it was like, this felt like a level beyond ancestors. It felt like I was with the ancients, like I was mm-hmm. being given a taste as to what the energies of the makings of civilization.
Yeah.
Kind of, and mm-hmm. and that was what I wanted to create with. And so, you know, for things like that, I knew that couldn't be, you know, something that was cotton or,
right, right.
or something like that,
right.
or, you know, things like that. And, you know, and then it's people always give me things. Yeah. And those things that I'm so reliant on, the things that people give me because they inspire me.
Yeah.
Like one little thing, like the marks may be what inspire a piece.
Yeah, absolutely.
But it is, you know, really for me, it's the touching because I will never know my African ancestors. Mm-hmm. And it allows me to have an interaction with them in the creation of something.
Understood.
And I think one of the things you touched on is that importance of a sense of place. And, you know, that was one of the things that was so special about Sacatar and doing Maria Felipe Gilabeda. Since then, I went to Ghana for residency and did a war shirt for a woman there. And upcoming, I have another residency in the place that the woman lived. So I am finding that that really adds a whole other dimension to making these shirts, is actually walking the land they walked and seeing seeing the nature they saw and all of that kind of stuff.
That is exactly where it comes from.
That is exactly it.
It is, you know, mine began in going to plantations when I visited plantations in 1999. And I literally felt the energy come into my body, and I saw things. And that was where, you know, my work changed in its most dramatic form.
Understood.
Well, we probably better get to some questions. We have a little bit of time. Let's see. Oh, okay. Gilbert Coker is asking us 3 different questions.
Okay.
Okay. Let's start with coarse cloth. Coarse cloth is an open weave. It is a rough yarn that is used, not a polish, like nothing that you would see like a mercerized cotton or something like that. It's very, and it does, and its color is very, very earth-like, is probably the best description.
It is. It still has a lot of what I guess we would call the trash in it. It hasn't.
Yes.
Should I take slow fashion?
Sure, you can
go. Okay. So slow fashion is simply a movement that has come around in the past few years, where it is less industrialized. So maybe there's hand dyeing or actually hand sewing, like Alabama Channon down in Alabama, where the clothes are all made by hand. It's really, I think, a response to fast fashion, which has, you know, happened in the past few years, where they use inferior materials, inferior making processes, all of that. And this is sort of bringing, trying to elevate fashion again, and also protect the environment by not using a lot of dyes that harm the environment, and also making things locally so that the carbon footprint is reduced, all of those kinds of things. That's slow fashion. Oh, and I guess I should do the other one for the hoodies. Okay. So the two people in the hoodies, black, okay, are a performance piece. Yes, it was a performance piece. The performance was these two young men standing still with their eyes closed, wearing these garments in a gallery for people to walk around. Why did I have these two young men in it? Because I wanted to reinforce the humanity of African Americans. And that's why there are two live men in these garments standing there wearing them. They would stand for 45 minutes at a time. They would take a 15-minute break. Then they would come back and stand for 45 minutes again. They were incredible. And as time went on, I found out that they both had the same first name and the same middle name, all out of the blue. It was so crazy. But and that they were amazing performers. And then the last hour of the last day that the show was up, I had the young man who was wearing the hoodie, I had a woman put it on and made a necklace for her. My friend's son laser cut it for me. Chris Harris, shout out. And to show that women too were victims of the state sanctioned violence. So that was the performance of that piece.
Okay, in the chat, we got an applause from Vanessa Harris.
Oh, that's Chris's mom, okay.
Oh, okay, that's great. And from Stephanie Sabo, I love the cloth and the clothing is important ways to communicate. Yes, similar disillusionment with the celebrity and the environmental consequences of fast fashion.
Yeah. Well, I think that I, like I said earlier, I think that is certainly being addressed with what happened with COVID. And one of the particular things that was all over all the fashion websites was that, I think it was Delhi, India, and they showed the difference in the sky within 24 hours of Delhi going on lockdown, how this sky that had not been clear for decades was blue with clouds. It was crystal clear just in 24 hours. So the environment does, we have the ability to repair. The environment has the ability to repair itself.
Well, we're getting some great thank yous. Well,
thank right you now, everyone, for listening.
Thank you so much. I just wanna, you know, really thank everyone. And again, thank the Center for Craft and BRM Productions for, yes, you know, for making this all possible. This has really been a dream of mine. And it's not done yet. I don't know what new form it will take, but you know, stay tuned. You know, Precious, thank you so, so very much.
And thank you, Karen, for inviting me. I so appreciate it. I really do.
Well, it was wonderful. And I have to, I think I have to go out on this note to everyone to tell them that, you know, in as we spoke before this all started, we just discovered that our birthdays are 2 days apart.
2 days apart. Yep.
So, well, thank you.
Thanks, everyone. Thank you so much, Karen.
Have a good day.
You too.
Bye.
Bye-bye.